now let's welcome John Hallsworthat.
Thank you. Okay, hello everybody. My name is John Hallsworthat and I'm going to talk to you about foods today. I'd like to start by saying thank you and sorry. I'd like to say thank you very much for the invitation to speak here. I'd like to say sorry because I'm not a food scientist. But actually I'm an environmental microbiologist. I specialise in cellular stress biology. But I will be talking about the implications of this work for foods and also pose some unanswered questions at the end. So, microbial quality of foods and feeds is a very important issue in terms of global food security, as I'm sure you know. Like Auriel said in his talk on the first day, the Earth is more than 40% dry mass, the terrestrial part of the Earth, desertification increasing, human population rising, food security is a huge problem. Foods, from the viewpoint of microorganisms, are a resource-rich habitat, so it's no surprise that so many foods are spoiled or contaminated with pathogenic species. Now, much is known about handling foods, transporting foods, storing foods, and trying to preserve foods by various techniques. However, the fact remains, globally, more than one-third of foods is still wasted. So food spoilage is a pressing issue. And in terms of fresh fruit and vegetables, typically about 50% of foods are wasted. And most of this is to do with fungal spoilage. Now, of course, it's part of the natural cycle of fruit and the release of seeds into the ecosystem that fruits decay in terms of fungal activity. Here you have a tomato, many fungal spores which penetrate plant structures, a melanite, and the melanin plays an important role in the penetration process. Here you have the fungal acrosorium, here you have the plant tissue, and you can see just here there's a very thin cell wall just here where it can penetrate the plant tissue. And then you can see a penetration peg growing into the plant tissue there. And this occurs both pre-harvest and post-harvest. Post-harvest, for example, in the fruits I just showed you. And here we have an example of pre-harvest. This is a fungal pathogen of rice, an important fungal pathogen of rice. And there's a number of plastic papers showing that glycerol accumulates to molar concentration, 6 or 7 molar, within the acrosorium. And this provides the hydraulic pressure for the penetration peg to penetrate the plant cuticle. Of course, cereals, staple crops of the human population on the planet, are also subject to fungal deterioration. And many of these fungi produce mycotoxins. Mycotoxins are toxic substances produced by fungi which are carcinogenic, mutagenic, tetragenic. I'm sorry, I'm not a medical expert, they're generally very bad for your health, immunosuppressive, cardiovascular problems. And some of the main crops contaminated are wheat, rice, maize, barley, oats, groundnuts, of course bread as well, although other foods as well. And many of these fungi are xerotolerant or xerophilic, meaning they can grow optimally under quite dry conditions at low water activity. So preventing contamination is particularly challenging. Now I made this slide to summarise the thermodynamic conditions under which microbes can function. Collectively, microbes on Earth are known to function. In terms of pH, there are some microbes, as you may know, some archaea, which function optimally close to pH 0, and can even grow below pH 0. There are one or two organisms known to be functional, metabolic active, and grow right up to pH 12. So generally speaking, for the microbial biosphere, and this is pertinent to foods, pH is not doesn't prevent microbial habitation. In terms of temperature, the highest temperatures at which microbes are known to function for some microbes are in the region of 115, 120 degrees C. And your domestic freezer is typically set at minus 20 degrees C, because the reports of microbes capable of proliferation right down to minus 18 degrees C. Many microbial systems and ecosystems live the whole life cycle at sub-zero temperatures. So generally speaking, pH and temperature are not very potent parameters on Earth or in food systems in terms of limiting microbial activity. By contrast, if you look at water activity is simply the mole fraction of water. It's measured on a scale from 0 to 1. And water activity is effectively the same as relative humidity. Relative humidity is the mole fraction of water in the vapor phase, in the gaseous phase, and arbitrarily has a maximum of 100. If you think of water availability in a food or soil or a liquid or solid, then we simply use the term water activity. It's the same as humidity, except the person who invented the scale gave it a maximum of 1. So a humidity of 80% is a water activity of 0.0. So what you can see here, by contrast with pH and temperature, water activity is a very potent determinant for microbial activity. Virtually all life on Earth can only take place in a tiny little window here, in a tiny thermodynamic window. So to put this in context, our own cells, mammalian cells, would die below this level. This is the water activity within the human system. Most terrestrial plants will wilt at 0.95, equivalent to a relative humidity of 95%. This is how much water living systems require. Many microbes wouldn't be able to grow below that level. Most microbes would never have any activity below 0.9. But to take some extreme examples for extremophiles, salt-saturated systems, 5 molar NaCl, have a water activity of 0.755. Some halophiles are adapted to that. And one of the most extreme reports of microbial activity, published in 1968, demonstrated spore germination at 0.605, equivalent to 60% humidity. So water is a very important aspect of food preservation, because low water availability can be used to prevent deterioration. So to put this in context for foods, fruits and vegetables, it's no wonder 50% of them are spoiled, have a very high water activity. Most microbes can happily function there. Something like a salami or honey is somewhere around 0.8, 0.85 because of salt in salami, because of sugar in honey. And by the way, there's very few bacteria that can actually be metabolically active in honey, which is typically about 0.8 or even less, I think. So one of the previous speakers talking about honey, I think some of the microbes present are probably not active in situ in the honey. Anyway, maple syrup has a much lower water activity, and dried fruits like pointed apricots can be in the range of 0.6. So I have a couple of hypotheses I'm going to talk about, but I'll just mention those in the appropriate place. I first want to make a comment about macromolecular flexibility. As an undergraduate student, I had a research experience in relation to toxicity, and it was my job to elucidate the mode of action of antifungal compounds, actually for Dow Chemical, so American chemical company. And compounds which have a target-specific mode of action. But then, as a postdoc on my first, then I did a PhD related to stress in fungal systems. And as a postdoc, I joined a yeast research group, and people there were working on ethanol toxicity. And I thought, yeah, that seems a bit strange to me, because ethanol doesn't have a specific mode of action. It has a biophysical impact throughout macromolecular systems, all over the cell, and regardless of phylogeny. It looks like a stressor to me, not a toxin. But when I tried to, from first principles, describe what ethanol was doing, well, it basically disorders all macromolecular systems in the cell. The membrane protein unravels DNA. It reduces non-covalent interactions because it's less polar than water. I didn't know at that time synthesis which do that are called caretropes. The caretropes are well known to biochemists, but bizarrely, biologists hadn't noticed that caretropes are behaving as caretropes in vivo, in the cell and in biological systems. And so at that time, I published a review called Ethanol-Induced Water Stress in Yeast, And then more recently wrote this article, Character Obesity, a Key Factor in Product Tolerance of Biofuel-Producing Microbes. But this isn't just about biofuels. All cells are full of metabolites and have solutes in the extracellular environment. And all solutes are either more or less polar than water, are either have a potential disordering effect or stabilization effect on the macromolecular system. So this issue is relevant to what I'm going to mention. So to go back to water activity now, I wanted to look further into the water activity limit for life. I didn't really believe that 0.605 is necessarily the limit for life, and I wanted to see if I could demonstrate biological activity below that level. So I actually went to Japan and went on, used this as an excuse for a world tour, went to some exciting countries, sampling for xerophilic fungi, sampling wooden structures in old Japanese buildings, for example, and also looked at the literature of the past 100 years to try and identify the most xerophilic strains ever reported, many of which were from the food industry, mostly isolated from prunes, dates, and things like that. So I had 200 or 300 fungi, and I grew them off all different types of media, agar, nutrient media. These media had stresses added to reduce the water activity, and I wanted to see how xerotolerant, xerophilic they were. So what you can see here is water activity is going from 0.71 right down to 0.644, but the chaotropic activity created by these stresses, mostly glycerol, sometimes different salts or sugars, the chaotropic activity or cosmotropic activity, the destabilizing or stabilizing activities of these solutes differed in each case. So you can see here two similar water activities, but a very highly chaotropic medium and a relatively neutral medium. And this is what we found. I'll just summarize this quickly. This was for 9 strains of the xerophilic fungi, the most xerophilic ones. These three at the bottom are xeromycin spisporus species. That's a sugar-loving xerophile found in dried fruits. These ones were mainly fungi which we isolated from dry surfaces, but they can, some of them can grow in salty places, some of them can grow at high sugar. We now know that most of these, a number of these were Aspergillus penicillioides strains. And what we found was, if you look at the pale yellow and grey colour here, the columns that go down in the slope, this is water activity, and water activity is reducing in this direction, down to 0.64. And so it gets more stressful in this direction. And if growth rate reduction was proportional to water activity reduction, then this is the trend you would expect to see in these columns here. But in black and orange here is the actual empirical data we obtained. In other words, when you look at these black ones here and here, what you can see is the particular combination of cosmotropicity that we use circumvented the water activity limit for these strains. In other words, if you translate that to foods, if you have glycerol, which is as a humectant, or naturally high glycerol foods, which is quite chaotropic, or high fructose foods, which is a chaotrope, or foods with magnesium chloride, or ethanol, which is chaotropic, the balance of these properties will have a big impact on microbial proliferation in the food, and this wasn't understood before. So actually, even though I showed you these graphs in relation to water activity, I want to remind you this is the very tip of the growth window of these microbes. This is water activity 1, equivalent to pure water, becoming more stressful in this direction. This is the growth optimum of this extreme xerophile. So if I put one of these histograms into context, this represents the very limit of life on Earth, the extremity of life on Earth, and indeed life within food systems. So we found that chaotropicity actually determined the water activity limit, not water activity per se, and its effects were reversible. We went on to look at halophile systems. Here you have halophiles in 5 grams of sodium chloride in a natural environment. But cheese and salami represents a thermodynamically equivalent environment. And the water activity of saturated sodium chloride is 0.755. So halophilic bacteria and archaea for the past 100 years or so have always been assumed to have a water activity limit a growth limit of 0.755 because you can't get any lower, because that's the saturation limit of NHCl. But when you look at the growth curves of some extreme xerophiles, you can actually see a 0.755 indicated by this pink line, equivalent to saturated NHCl. They're still growing quite happily, some of them close to optimum, and you get a feeling from the growth kinetics that they're capable of proliferating at much lower lower water activities. Now, this is a very simple study. We changed the salts in the medium to see if they could grow at lower water activity. If I say it in five words like that, it sounds very simple. It took me 15 years to achieve this. It's actually complicated to understand the cellular system and complicated to understand the kind of salts and the kind of medium required to reduce the water activity without causing a new stress parameter, such as hydrophobicity, to come in and limit the system. So this was a remarkably simple study that took an embarrassingly long period of time. Maybe six of my research students, 15 years to achieve this. But finally, we did demonstrate that this isn't really a surreal work of art, that something happened here to make these problems rise up, I think. We actually demonstrated microbial proliferation right down of halophiles, right down to 0.681, which was unprecedented. But it's proof of principle that the composition of a substrate, the composition of foods, and the composition of metabolites within a cell has a big impact on the growth windows, the thermodynamic windows for biotic activity, and the water activity minima for microbial proliferation, which is very important to understand in the context of food preservation. So here we understood this shows the most xerophilic microbes that grow with less water than anything understood on Earth in Earth's biosphere. Here we have bacteria and archaea in saline systems. Here we have eukaryotes, mainly xerophilic fungi, in high sugar systems. And you can see that these fungi were understood to be more stress tolerant. But actually, as a result of our experiments, we showed halophiles are equally stress tolerant in terms of water activity. So we published this paper, is there a common water activity limit for the three domains of life? Of course, we believe we showed there is, but the editor forced us to put that question out there. in terms of xerophiles here, these are maybe most pertinent to food spoilage and also mycotoxin production. So what we wanted to do was, this is the limit for life on Earth, effectively, which determines food preservation. This is more or less used by the food industry to determine how much sugar and salt to put in foods and how dry to store foods. This value of 0.605, which came about from a 1968 study. So we wanted to challenge that value. I couldn't help thinking, even though 15 years and a lot of effort passed by, I was determined to challenge that value and show microbes could do more than that if we could only understand under what conditions. So, a couple of years ago, I embarked on a study of fungal germination with the most extreme xerophiles that we managed to find. We just found the conditions to optimize germination, pH, temperature, things like that. And then we did some extensive studies, and I'll just summarize them. I'll say we managed to get Saccharomyces bisporus to germinate only down to 0.637, not 605 like the 1968 study. For Aspergillus penicillioides, down to 0.604, 640, which was a record for that species. And a Eurotium species, which is halotolerant, to 0.651. Aspergillus penicillioides all over the environment. You can find it growing in books, in soils, sugary places, salty places, dry surfaces, surface of trees, it's all over the place. When you look at the kinetics of germination, the germination we obtained here was more rapid than anything else before. And what we did was we cultured the subcultures on very high glycerol media, which encouraged the spores to hyperaccumulate glycerol. This glycerol acts as a stress protectant, it acts osmotically, and it massively boosts vigor and also reduces the water activity window, water activity minimum. And then we germinated them on high glycerol media with particular KO cosmotropes added, And so these are the kind of things we manipulated, and we got more vigorous activity than ever reported before. So we published a paper showing that glycerol enhances fungal germination at the water activity limit for life. Frustratingly, we still didn't break through that thermodynamic barrier. But when we extrapolated our data, extrapolations suggested a theoretical minimum below 0.6 water activity. So obstinately, we didn't give up. My PhD student was about to finish his project. I said, "No, Andy, come on, one last experiment. You can do it." And kicking and screaming for Andy, who published 14 papers from his PhD, and I was pushing him for another one, did a final experiment. And we simply harvested the conidia from the fungal cultures dry instead of in a liquid medium. We did some simple things like kept the plate sealed so we wouldn't lose any water availability during the experiment, used microscopy to examine the fungal germination in a sealed plate, things like this. And finally, what we found in this set of experiments was fungal germination of 0.585 water activity, mainly fueled by glycerol in the way I just mentioned, but just by tweaking our experimental conditions. And we explained in the paper on this topic, this is very pertinent to many microbial habitats where cells do come in contact with that much glycerol. And here are the germination spores as well. So I want to say, move on to keratopicity. Keratopicity limits cellular systems, in fact it limits life on Earth, and many grass substances which are generally regarded as safe by the food industry and can be added to foods like ethanol, magnesium chloride, sodium benzoate, fructose, glycerol, are keratopic. And we showed in a study some years ago, this was a study of a bacterium, but I believe the results would be similar for any microbial system. This is four protein stabilization proteins in a control culture, which didn't have any stresses added to the medium. When we add a K-drug to the medium, in this case phenol, you can see a large upregulation of these protein stabilization proteins. And if you inhibit growth in a different way, extremes of pH, heavy metals, for example, you don't have an increase in these proteins. So this increase is not just because the system is stressed and growth inhibited. This is specifically a response to a cell whose macromolecular systems have been disordered, and the cell is upregulating macromolecule protection systems, not just in terms of protection of proteins. There were proteome changes related to changes in membrane composition, DNA repair, and keratopes cause lipid peroxidation because of the keratopic activity, which causes free radicals for release and oxidative stress, which I think may relate to cadmium that one of our speakers spoke about the other day. We went on to show, I don't have time to mention this work, keratopicity limits life on Earth in some places, and in the same way it limits life in food systems. That's why fermented drinks never have more than about 12% alcohol. You have to distill or supplement the alcohol, because keratopicity limits microbial systems after that. Now, even though keratopicity has a big role in life on Earth, it had never been quantified. We have scales of measurement for Celsius from 300 years ago, pressure from 400 years ago, pH from 100 years ago. There were no units and no method to quantify keratopicity. So we actually used, again, I'm good at very embarrassingly simple experiments that maybe high school children can do. We got a solution of agar, added different substances, and looked at the gelation temperature. And using that system, we quantified keratopicity and produced that article. Let me skip a couple of slides here. We also showed, okay, I'll try and get to the end. We also showed, we know that at sub-zero temperatures, microbes can proliferate. This is sea ice algae. There's a huge ecosystem here which functions at sub-zero temperatures. And this is very pertinent to food preservation. Even when foods are frozen, you can have a lot of microbial activity there. But what we showed, that was no. What we showed was keratopic substances in the cell, or keratopic substances in a substrate such as foods, can enhance microbial growth at low temperature, and can reduce the temperature minima for microbial growth. by 5 or 10 degrees C. So if you have a microbe, for example, that can spoil foods, and it can grow right down to minus 5 degrees C, if there's a high level of caryotrope in the food, it can actually grow possibly down to minus 15 degrees C, a huge thermodynamic jump in the growth window caused by caryotropes. And we also showed microbes preferentially accumulate caryotrophic solutes under low temperature conditions. This is relevant to fermentations like sake fermentation, which occurs at low temperature, gives a very high ethanol yield, for example. Skip forward. This work is quite pertinent to astrobiology, where Enceladus, a moon of Saturn, gives off quite a lot of water and is thought to be potentially habitable. Europa, which is characterized by brine oceans at low temperature, with very high magnesium chloride concentrations, thought to be habitable. And actually, you might recognize my hairstyle there. NASA invited me onto quite a number of expert panels in relation to these kind of questions. And actually, being involved a little bit recently in astrobiology, one of the questions is, can Mars be contaminated by accident by terrestrial microbes during space exploration? And there's notably brine on Mars, there's a lot of ice, this is a meteorite impact on Mars, and subsurface ice come to the surface. And I just want to show you a quick video, it just lasts a few seconds. And one of the things that came up on this particular NASA panel was that thin films spontaneously form on the surface of minerals, in fact on Earth, on the surface of plant leaves, and I'm absolutely certain within foods as well. Thin films which are invisible to the naked eye, and which may be from 2 or 3 water molecules thick, right up to a millimeter thick, but generally invisible to the naked eye. And I want to show you this little video, which lasts a few seconds, is taken on a pine needle. And this pine needle happens to have a tiny crystal of salt. This is a stomata and a pine needle, tiny crystal of salt. And as the humidity changes, what you can see is the salt deliquesces, and this thin film falls on the pine needle. That thin film is invisible to the naked eye, but if you're a microbial cell, that might as well be the Atlantic Ocean. That's as much water, far more water than a cell or microbial community will need. And this principle, I think, is very pertinent to foods. A lot of contamination occurs, even though the water activity looks like it's hostile, and I'm certain that this is very often because of thin film formation. The work is right on a number of unanswered questions, but I won't bore you with those. I'd just like to thank my research group. I have 200 scientific collaborators involved in some of this work. I'd particularly like to thank my ex-boss, Ken Tinnis. I'd like to say a special thank you to my collaborator and friend, Elias Nakaleka. Thank you.
Thank you, John. We still do not have time for questions if we really want to keep the schedule. So I'm sorry, and I'm sure that there will be an announcement concerning the board election. Elias?
Yes. Thank you very much, Joa. And thank you, John, for pushing the limits of our scientific comprehension further.